music. It's the love of music that brings us together. The love of music that forms the bond between us. For the next hour, join us for the love of music, presenting those aspects of music which excite, provoke, and inspire. Our host today is David Dubal, WNCN Music Director, pianist, educator, and writer on music. Here is David Dubal for the love of music.
This is David Dubal, and today we have part two of a mini-series with the great pianist Grant Johannesen, who also is one of the favorite sons of Utah. Born in Salt Lake City, I would guarantee, Grant, that you must be, by now, well, if some people are Louisville colonels or Kentucky colonels, you should have some sort of medal from that state, if not the governorship.
Well, as a matter of fact, I should say that's sheer nonsense, but I have to tell you that when I went on the first tour I made of the Soviet Union, the state of Utah elected to create a day in my honor, and that's I don't know how closely it's been adhered to. I don't see people falling on their faces on May 17th when
every year.
Every year.
Oh, wonderful.
But it exists.
I'm glad I know about that, because it's about time at least one major pianist had a day from a state. I think it's great.
Well, you know, the French have always been marvelous, mm-hmm. the way they put plaques on the mm-hmm. houses of favorite creative people. Not only creative people, but, of course, politicians and writers. But they do like musicians in France very much. And I remember the last time I was in Mr. Casadesus' house, there was the inevitable plaque, and the mayor of Paris said, cordoned off the street to create the proper atmosphere, and it's quite remarkable how they respect their deceased people.
Now, what about Americans? Do we respect our artists?
I don't know. But I've always thought that we still are very youth-oriented in America, and you know, we don't quite trust people who develop in their professions. Mm-hmm. They're suspicious. Maybe not writers, but I think musicians. We expect them to flare up and be brilliant things, and then quickly sort of get into the teaching profession or something.
Uh-huh.
Like that.
Disappear and live a respectable life, because possibly musicians in the public eye still have this flamboyant eccentricity label to them. Is that possible?
I suppose it is. Although, thank God, we don't change our names much anymore mm-hmm. in the music profession. It used to be that, you know, if you had a name like, what was Madame Stokowski, Samarov's
yes,
maiden name?
Yes, it was not Slavic enough.
No, it was a real Texas name.
Hickenlooper.
Yeah, Hickenlooper.
Mm-hmm.
And it those things didn't work.
Well, she changed it to Samarov, and then, of course, she added from the Samarov to Stokowski, and he, of course, changed his name from
Stokes.
Stokes. So I think...
Yes, but this doesn't seem to be necessary anymore, and I think it's a marvelous thing that, you know, we simply take people for their given names and stay with it, and they can become, you know, as illuminated and as fascinating as any other fancy Russian or French name.
Yes. That is wonderful, but I am very glad to know that there is Grant Johannesen Day in Salt Lake. Now, do you go back there to your home state often?
Very often, yes. Mm-hmm. I have. they have been wonderful to me in that city. I've played with that orchestra, I guess, I don't know how many times. I couldn't tell you, but I've traveled with them on two different European tours they made. And it really is very much home for me, even though I was in New York for 32 years and subsequently in Cleveland, where I am also known now, I'm sure, as a local pianist.
That's wonderful. As president of the Cleveland Institute as well. Now, that is a good orchestra in Salt Lake City.
Very good. Very
Ravenel
good.
Is the conductor.
He
right?
was the conductor up until just a couple of years ago. But I think he had the longest tenure of anyone outside of Ormandy.
Now, today...
Maybe Goldschmidt in St. Louis uh-huh. had an equally long period. But there are very few people in this country who have stayed with an orchestra.
Well, he was extremely well-known in Salt Lake City. I mean,
He loved, you know, the thing is, there was a man who came from a European cultivation, and he was a great friend of Kurt Weill, created all those works in Europe. And when he came to the States, he was booked originally to conduct French opera at the Metropolitan. But he had, when he was asked to go to Salt Lake City, he had a coup de foudre. You know, he absolutely fell in love mm-hmm. with Salt Lake, and he didn't want to move from there at all. He was asked to conduct in many places, guest conduct at any rate, but he really built the orchestra the way a great conductor would.
And I think that he was very honored there, without a doubt, and I think he made a great career there.
He was a city father. That's what he was.
Now, you're certainly a favorite son of Utah, but you are, without a doubt, a world citizen, hardly a local pianist in Cleveland. You have played... Now, for quarter century, everywhere there's a piano to be had, you would sit down and you would play often music that was not even heard in the capitals of the world of music.
You're right. I don't think it is a right condition, but I must say that I'm always surprised when I've played in certain parts of the world music by... Oh, for instance, in South America, Camargo Guarnieri mm-hmm. wrote some marvelous piano music, but hardly known over there in São Paulo. And I just feel that, you know, one of the great things about playing the piano is that, you know, you have an endless garden of delights there and strong music. After all, we're dealing with, you know, tremendous quality. And I just, as we've said before, we both feel the same, that it's a shame that pianists don't seek out the music that suits them best and without any other consideration, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if like Arthur Rubinstein had a successful program back in 1940, legions of pianists felt they had to be heard in that same program mm-hmm. in order to be, you know, in the running, so to speak.
Yes, it's amazing. Why is it, and there's no doubt it's true, that pianists seem to follow the leader? If Horowitz played a certain piece, that would be on the programs in the next few years.
Yes. How the Scriabin surge came up was because Horowitz was so interested in Scriabin. Not only that, but I find that happens not in music, but certainly in the theater. You know, what goes on Broadway is repeated out in local playhouses mm-hmm. all over the country the following year. Why should it be? Why should they simply follow a trend?
Yes.
When there's such a great body of work that can be exploited for, you know, local purposes.
And your own purpose, meaning your own temperamental
yes.
desires to show in what really works for you musically. Yeah.
Well,
you
that's
said
where
Guarnieri. You have a wonderful on Golden Crest recording of 20 of his 50 preludes, something like that.
Yes.
Well, these are wonderful and affable and enchanting works. Who knows that this man also wrote 6, 7, 8 sonatinas that are just so wonderful.
5
so
concerti
big
for piano.
Toccata that is as good as any toccata.
Yeah.
And this goes on, and it's just a shame.
Yeah, it's true. I mean, well, we are not terribly enterprising, I'm afraid, where piano repertory is concerned. So, and it is a great shame because there it is. It's lying in wait.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Now, I'll ask a question about the French repertoire, which you're certainly always exposing to audiences. You just played at the Pierpont Morgan Library, the Fauré Theme and Variations, which, of course, is a rather famous piece for Fauré. But is there a problem in exporting French music? It seems that outside of Debussy, Fauré or Chabrier or you name the composer, and they love the piano, the French composers.
Yeah.
They don't seem to be played in Russia. They don't seem to be played in America.
Well, they're always highly respected composers.
Always.
Who are not played in a great abundance. But you know, I know on your station you play a great deal of French music. You know, things that are recorded. You know, the music is much appreciated.
For what I do for French music as a programmer, I should have a day in Paris, as you do in Salt Lake City, because it's...
Absolutely.
But nobody honors me either, so, I mean, it's...
Well,
okay, I'll stop that train of thought. You know, we're going to hear today Mozart, Casadesus, Chabrier, and Chopin, not the Chopin of the Fantasy Impromptu, although you play it beautifully, but his Variations Brillantes Opus 12, and that's what we'll conclude with. But, Grant, we're going to start with that Amadeus man.
Oh, yes.
He's certainly
now known as Amadeus man.
Yeah. He's, and of course, he's well known as a movie composer, as Elvira Madigan.
Never forget it.
Yeah. And again, though, we're not going to hear the big fantasy in C minor that is well known to the sonata, are we? We're going to hear another big fantasy in C minor.
This is also a big fantasy of Mozart, but it's, you know, this is an interesting one that was also existed in a version with violin.
Yes. We're going to hear your recording, I believe it's a Golden Crest recording, of the C minor Fantasy K 396 by Amadeus. Mozart.
Thank you.
You have heard Grant Johannesen in the Mozart Fantasy in C minor, K396, from his Golden Crest album. And we will be back with discussion with my guest, Mr. Johannesen, after these messages. This is David Dubal, and today, part two of Grant Johannesen. And we're going to hear next some pieces by Robert Casadesus, who he studied with and who he continues to champion because he is a wonderful composer. We'll hear some Chabrier later and Chopin. But I want to say this, that Grant Johannesen is one of these pianists who has always taken chances. And he was in the forefront of recording things on the LP which had never been heard. And in many ways, I would call you, Grant, a pioneer, because many young pianists today, or many that are not necessarily stars, sit and they, I'm sure from your example, went and looked at the literature and they said, ah, yes, nobody wants my Carnival, they said, but my goodness, I'll learn this Casella work and so forth. So in many ways, you are the progenitor of a whole breed of pianists who have worked on their own and then interested a record company, or the record company told them about the work. It didn't matter. And we now have a library of music, at least on LP, not live performance, that is a wide example of this fantastic literature of Western music.
Well, this is what recordings are all about.
Absolutely.
As I see it.
Mm-hmm. You're coming out with a new one.
Yes, I have a new one. I recorded in Stuttgart for Pantheon, that new company that George Mendelssohn has now. That well, he became, if you know George Mendelssohn, he has always been most interested in a large body of literature and packaged his things so beautifully in the past.
The inventor of the Vox Box and
yes.
so many interesting things.
But this fascinated him because when I was in the Soviet Union, oh, it must have been 8 years ago, they had just published the complete works of Liszt. And among the things I came back with on that trip were the Beethoven songs arranged by Liszt. There are six Goethe-Lieder, six Gelertlieder, the cycle An die ferne Geliebte, and Adelaide, the marvelous
most
cantata
one,
that
yeah.
Was published originally as a cantata. You know, it's a
know
two-part
that.
Song. But in Liszt's arrangement for piano, he has, between the slow and the fast parts of the song, he creates one of those incredibly inventive things. It's, I guess you should call it a cadenza, which ruminates on the themes of the first section. And that is pure Liszt, I must say.
Mm-hmm.
But most of the other songs he did rather respectfully, not quite as ornamented as some of the Schubert songs. But the An die ferne Geliebte he had such a respect for that although he transcribes it, and it's a rather difficult piece for the piano, it comes out sounding like a late Beethoven sonata.
Mm-hmm.
It's quite fascinating. You know, that cycle has no, there are no breaks between the six songs,
yes.
So that it can become a very interesting piano piece.
So, and it's just ideal for most of a side of a record then, right?
Yes, those songs fit. I did the whole body of the those that Liszt had arranged, and they make one whole record.
So you'll be doing then on this new release. What is the record company?
Pantheon.
I can't wait to get it. That should be out shortly.
It is out in Germany now, but it's coming out. I think it may already be out. I haven't seen the copy yet.
Grant, the next music we're going to play for our audience today is by Robert Casadesus, and you just very recently played in New York with Frederick Waldman, his Capriccio for piano and orchestra work, I don't know.
It's piano and string orchestra,
uh-huh.
Yes.
Grant, we're going to hear the Trois berceuses, the three lullabies, right? And tell me about this little set.
They were written, I would say, between 1927 and 1932. The first one, which is rather startling if you know Casadesus, because it's a blues, a French style blues, but it's an American idea. He wrote that for the birth of his son John, and the other two are rather sad, reflective pieces. If you think of a berceuse as being a sort of a nice rhythm and rather happy, I think you'd find these quite a little different, except perhaps the first one. But he was, as Ravel was and as Roussel was, and Mio particularly, very interested in American jazz. And
the French just loved those dance forms, from the foxtrot to the...
And, of course, the most fascinating of all is Stravinsky's piano rag music and ragtime, I think. Those are marvelous pieces.
Yes, absolutely. You've recorded that.
Yes.
Unbelievable. We're going to hear Robert Casadesus, or Robert Casadesus, and we're going to hear Trois Berceuses, and the artist, Grant Johannesen.
Thank you.
You have just heard beautiful, beautiful music that is unknown by Robert Casadesus, Trois Berceuses, and the artist, my guest today, Grant Johannesen. And after these messages, we'll be right back with more talk, discussion, and Chabrier. My guest today, Grant Johannesen, who has forever been championing works of art that are not well known. Chabrier is a composer that is infinitely fascinating. He was a fascinating person, and his output is most interesting. We're only going to get a little taste of him today, but let's discuss Chabrier.
Yes, when you think of Chabrier, you know, we really don't know the size of that man's gift, but he was the inspiration for so many composers, you know, and he himself was very much influenced, strangely enough, by Wagner.
Mm-hmm.
You know his opera,
Gwendolyn.
It's
the overture is very.
Oh yes,
Wagner. So
they're amazing pieces. But you know, I remember once sitting in a master class of Casadesus when his wife suddenly came into the room and said, "You know, this is the 70th anniversary today of the publication of the Bourrée Fantasque." And of course, most of us thought, "Well, yes, isn't that interesting?"
Yeah.
Sort of thing. But then Robert went on and said, well, the reason we feel so strongly about that piece in France is that we think maybe it might have been the first modern piece of music written.
And so true. And his last piano piece.
Yes.
Chabrier's
last piano piece. But it's a kind of a toccata, but it's a... I could understand why he feels that this was a very important work in the history of music.
Yes, and isn't this wonderful? Because we're discussing the fact, and a woman comes into the room and says, "This is not the 70th anniversary of the death of Lenin or whatever. This
yeah.
is the 70th anniversary of the publication of this Chabrier piece," and. These are the things you can't put in words, because when you say this may well be the first modern piece, certainly of French music, I know what you're talking about,
yes.
and yet I cannot verbalize it.
No, it's very hard to do, but you know, this is where musicians understand each other very well, and the fascination of a statement like that, which is rather an original remark. It was typical of Casadesus, but you know, it was those people lived in music in such a special way.
He came from a glorious line of
back
musicians.
Back to Louis XIV, you know, they were court composers and court actors in the theater with Molière, and they still are. The amazing thing, Giselle Casadesus is one of the great Molière interpreters at the Comédie Française now.
I didn't know.
Yes, that is. And her son is Jean-Claude Casadesus, who is a conductor now of one of the French orchestras.
And there was Marius Casadesus.
Marius
yeah.
was, yes. He and the had the ancient instruments mm-hmm. ensemble in Paris. Those people, you know, at a time when really old music was not too much respected, that is.
Yes, that's right.
They kept the whole torch of harpsichord.
It was all called ancient music.
Ancient music, yes.
So interesting.
It is very interesting. And who was the one who wrote the viola concerto by Handel?
Yes.
You know, which now is known as Handel Casadesus, but...
Isn't that interesting?
It's a very lovely piece, and it was never by Handel. It was...
Well, certainly... your teacher, Casadesus, had within his genetic pool everything from Couperin to Chabrier. He seemed to understand the whole aesthetic range of not only French music, which he did incomparably. His Debussy and Ravel have something that no other pianist ever brought to it.
Well, it belongs to the great tradition, you know. You can understand when Debussy wrote a homage to Rameau, it doesn't sound like Rameau in any way, but it was a true homage.
Yeah.
It was like and the Tempo de Couperin, too. Those people have always been totally obsessed with the history of music
yes.
in that country.
And you know, and it would infect everyone. Franck would come. Of course, Franck became French, a naturalized citizen, born in... Belgium, right?
Belgium,
but
yes.
When he heard Chabrier, the ten the picturesque
yes.
pieces. He said, Franck said, this is one of the great events of French music, you know, linking our past to the present.
Such a, you know, people think that Franck and Dandy represented one other aspect of French musical life, but they appreciated each other enormously.
What are we going to hear of Chabrier? It's 1 minute and 28 seconds.
Oh, this is a very lovely piece, a Ballabile. Dance piece. Isn't that a marvelous name?
Yes.
Ballabile.
Ballabile. And it's just one of his occasional works, right? It has
yes.
not part of a suite.
No, this is a part from...
And you heard it and you said, Grant Johannesen must learn this too, right?
Oh, yes.
And that's... Yes. Oh, yes. You just take it for granted.
Why not?
Right, why not? And we are benefiting from that state of mind when we now hear the Chabrier piece in the hands of my guest today, Grant Johannesen. Grant Johannesen has just played Ballabile by Chabrier, and after these messages, one of them, two, perhaps three messages, I do not know, frankly, we will be back with a composer totally unknown to us all, Frédéric François Chopin. We are back. Grant Johannesen today is my guest. Last week he was too. And if he had time, I would like to speak to him in 30 or 50 or 100 programs because he certainly has the discography to do that. Now, Chopin is a composer that you have, of course, played in so many concerts. What is it that has in this man a universality, that he's understood in Brazil and Japan, not only as a Polish composer, but as a world composer? He seems to touch everyone.
I think, you know, there was a time when Chopin was not thought to be a composer who embraced the great heroism in music, as Beethoven did. But do you know that the older I get, the more I love the heroic aspect of Chopin? And it isn't just because of the Polonaises,
no.
But there is such an enormous dignity and actually heroism. That's, you can understand why he was so, even though he lived in France the greater part of his life when he was composing, he still reflected something indigenous that was... has to do with his own country. And I think that any great composer does, in the end.
Mm-hmm.
They reflect this mystique of their homeland. Now, you think, because he himself was not overly strong, I wonder, you know, I often wonder how he played a piece like the first scherzo,
mm-hmm.
which is a terrifying mood piece and of enormous anguish and deep
naughty and growling,
yes.
Internal growling.
But how, if it's true that his own way of playing the piano was so refined and so, how did he play a piece like this in the last movement of the B minor sonata?
Didn't he say he envied Liszt's strength? And one of his pupils, Gutmann, he said, "I wish I could play my scherzo in C sharp minor that way with all of that." And someone once played very loud his military polonaise, and he said, "If I had the strength, I would crash the piano." But he didn't have the strength. He was tubercular, and he was down to 95 pounds, and those last years were tragic. And yet, you know, I also, Grant, hear that lion in his soul.
There it is. There's an enormous, enormous male feeling of heroic destiny in that music.
Yes.
It's such great music.
And a tenacity of spirit, you know. I think it's so important that pianists like yourself have given us interpretations of the virile Chopin instead of the Chopin that has been nocturnized.
What is called the morbidezza.
The morbidezza and the tears and the moonlight school.
Yes, no. He was much, much more than that, believe me.
And, now, he had many sides, and he had his salon side on a certain level. And in his day, especially when these were written around 1831, it was the great age of an emerging virtuoso school. And he was in Paris with Thalberg and so many others, and he said, "Well, I too can write these brilliant kind of variations." One day I was discussing these variations, Grant, with my own teacher, Arthur Lesser, who you certainly knew of very well as part of the Cleveland Institute of Music. And I don't know if it was a perverse moment with Arthur, but usually when he said something, he meant it in one way or another, and he played for me the variations we're about to hear. Opus 12, based on an opera theme of the day, and he said to me, "You can have your Brahms Handel. I love this. The Brahms Handel too pretentious for me." He says, "These are masterpieces."
It's I think because after Chopin wrote this literature, he became such a profound writer. But these are examples of absolutely masterful elegance in music, no doubt about it. But as you say, living at a time when the piano was becoming a great display instrument, look at the etudes. I mean, they go so far beyond the horrendously difficult technical considerations that have to be made when you're addressing yourself to the same. But the music in them is still the most interesting thing about the etudes, and they are endlessly interesting.
Immortal poetry.
That is an incredible body of literature. Yes. I would say that, you know, even though one doesn't like to compare anything, but before these 24 etudes, it was the 48 of Bach.
Yeah.
Preludes and Fugues that you think of as being the first great compendium for the keyboard.
For the hands, the human hands.
This must be the second one, I think.
Yeah. Well, I think Honecker said that the well-tempered will live for the 17th century and the for the 18th century, for the 17th, the 18th century will be the Beethoven sonatas, and the 19th century will be the Chopin etudes.
Not bad.
He says, when everything else fashioned by mortal hand is gone, the Chopin etudes will survive.
These are the desert island pieces you're speaking
about. Yeah, these are the real desert island. And we're going to hear a piece really just charming and never played, because there's so much great music that is played in Chopin's output. But again, you have given us a piece that deserves hearing for that elegance that it states. And we're now going to hear your recording, Grant Johannesen, in Chopin's Variations Brillantes, Opus 12. Oh, what a charming work. The Variations Brillantes Opus 12 by Frédéric Chopin, and the artist, the great pianist Grant Johannesen, who has graced the studios of WNCN these last two programs. Grant, we have a second or two. What are your plans for the next day or two?
Oh, well, the next day or two, I'm involved with... Right now, I'm away from the Institute on tour, so I'm playing a couple of recitals. I just played with the Atlanta Symphony a couple of weeks ago and with the Utah Symphony last weekend. I'm going down to Louisiana from here to play the Chopin Second Concerto.
Wonderful.
And then I'm coming back to New York to do a very interesting recital with Julius Baker.
Mm-hmm. And so you're busy as usual.
Oh, yes, business as usual,
yeah,
as they say.
Business as usual. Well, in the spring or whenever you can get back, please come back and talk to me, and let's hear more of your art, because I love to hear it.
Thank you.
This is David Dubal, and thank you for listening.
For the Love of Music, with today's host, David Dubal, WNCN Music Director. We hope you'll be with us when once again we meet to listen and exchange ideas, all for the love of music. For the Love of Music is produced by WNCN New York, GAF Broadcasting Company.